It's the Forensic Lunch!
My name is Dave.
And I'm Matthew.
And I should turn down the sound effects on the other mics as well. with us this week, very excited about this, we have Anu Sun.
Hello, happy to be here.
Jason Brooks.
Hey guys, thanks for having me.
Matt Bromley.
Hello, happy to be here.
And in the studio, the esteemed Lee Woodfield.
Howdy.
So I think we have probably one of the more jam-packed episodes we've had in a very long time, with some very interesting content for everyone to follow. And I think whether you're watching this live or recorded, you're going to get a lot from this, and I think you're going to see the future of some of these projects we're talking about. So all that being said, let's get straight into it. And by alphabetical order, it's clear winner is Anu Sun. So, how are you?
I'm doing very well. How are you doing?
Doing great. Let's. Obviously, I know you. I've seen you present before. I know you as a SANS instructor. But tell everyone about yourself. How did you get to this point in life?
Sure. So again, my name is Anuj Soni. I am a senior incident responder with Booz Allen Hamilton, so I've been performing incident response for a little over 9 years now. Thoroughly enjoyed it. I'm originally just some brief personal info, I suppose. I'm from Bucks County, which is a little north of Philadelphia, and I currently reside in D.C., where I've been for about 10 years now. So in terms of how I initially got into malware, I mean, as you mentioned before, I'm now a SANS instructor for the Forensics 610 course, which is reverse engineering malware. I've been teaching with SANS for about 2 years, which has been an amazing experience. I probably got into malware in the way that most people did, which is that, as an incident responder, I've been obviously working incidents. And, the hope is that if, for example, you are investigating a potential intrusion, that at some point you actually get to the files associated with that intrusion and determine the root cause, the timeline and events, and ideally, who actually did this, who actually perpetrated the attack. And so, what I found before I really knew much about malware was that, the forensics was very interesting. Putting that timeline together was always very exciting. But I'd get to this point where I had to hand off something to another person. And don't get me wrong, I'm all for collaboration, and I think every intrusion investigation requires it. But at the same time, I felt motivated to kind of empower myself to really be able to close that loop a bit and understand, what it is that I found. And so it's gotten to the point with my passion for kind of ripping apart malware that incident response for me is really just a means to an end. It's all about finding that malware, and for me that's where the real fun begins, because that's where I find I have to think the most creatively, and I don't know, that really puts my skills and my knowledge to the test, and the learning really never stops, and when I'm in an environment where I'm constantly confused and want to bang my head against the wall, I find that while it's irritating at first, when I get some perspective, that's really where I am most comfortable, because that's really what's most rewarding is when you're constantly learning. And that's what happens every time I go at a sample.
And I think what's interesting is that the idea of what is malware is kind of, the name itself, malicious software, has always been nice and broad. But I think a lot of people's perspective of what malware is or was is kind of expanding. And, and I think as the categorization goes, some of the research you've been doing into attacker toolkits and web shells and things like that obviously fit in that bucket. And I think a lot of people initially don't think about that. They think malware is that thing that's part of the initial dropper. It's part of that thing that does the initial exploitation. But they don't really think about the persistence or the backdoors or all the rest as kind of being within that family of things that are interesting to look into.
Yeah, absolutely. And I suppose, calling things malware initially is kind of, guilty before being proven so, which perhaps is not the right way to go. I try to use the word suspect file as much as possible. But at the end of the day, although my clients might disagree, I really want what I'm looking at to be malware, right? Because if it's not, that means I have, more looking to do. And you're absolutely right. I've been doing some more research into web shells. Web shells I have found to be pretty interesting. I mean, I really only started encountering them on incident response cases about a year and a half ago. Until then, I certainly knew what they were. They've been around for well over a decade. And I'm sure most people, you know, in the audience here have heard of them as well. But I hadn't really dug deep into them until I started encountering them. And so, you know, if I can provide kind of a brief overview of some of my lessons learned during web shell cases. So for those who aren't aware, you know, web shell is a type of malware that's generally placed on a compromised public-facing server. And they're very similar to remote administration tools, or RATs, in that they allow an adversary remote access to a target machine. They can upload files, download files, manipulate files. In many cases, they can even access back-end resources, such as customer databases or financial information. But in my opinion, they don't get the attention they deserve, and they're, in fact, in some ways much worse than RATs because they're typically much smaller, right? I've seen web shells that are literally, you know, 10 or 20 bytes in length. They're platform independent because they're generally based on server-side technologies, whether it's PHP or ASP or, as in my experience, JSP. They're also very customizable, which makes them very easy to avoid any sort of AV detection. And they also don't use typical command and control channels. So it's not a case where you have a piece of malware beaconing out to a C2 server. In this particular case, for attackers to access it and take control over the compromised machine, they really just have to browse to it, and it makes it really hard to differentiate that from normal web traffic, particularly if this is on a web server, which is where it is many times. So, you know, the good news with web shells, the kind of the sunny part of the day, is that when you do find them, you know, they're pretty easy to understand with the help of perhaps someone who's perhaps a better programmer than I, because you usually have the source code there right in front of you. The hard part, however, is actually finding them. Because, like I said, they can be very small. In cases I've seen, they've just been appended to what is otherwise a very normal file on a web server. And so, you know, sifting through a large data set, particularly if it's a web server where there's a lot of non-static content, where things are updated often, is pretty difficult. So, you know, there are some tools out there that can help. A lot of them are signature-based, which we all know here probably has some limitations. Others look at the entropy of files across the file system, you know, looking for obfuscated or encrypted content, which is something that some web shells include in them. The most effective tools I found to look for what are otherwise known as dangerous calls, you know, eval functions, exec functions. And in fact, you can even create your own script, just a simple shell script that literally looks across the file system or, you know, your publicly available directories. And looks for some of those dangerous functions just by grepping through them. That can be pretty effective, too. Some other things I found, you know, whitelisting was also effective, although a little bit more complicated. Do you have a question?
I was going to say, I've had a couple clients who had success initially finding it, not realizing they were looking for it. When they did comparisons, they were good clients in that they had good source code revisions and control, so they were able to compare the check-in and what should be part of the life set against what was actually in the web server and found the web shells there.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, along with that, integrity checking solutions can help quite a bit. I mean, I had one client that had a Unix-based machine, and they had AID, the integrity checker, installed on the box. And it was installed on the box for the simple purpose of, you know, determining whether or not their deployed code was actually on the machine. But in reality, it was actually probably the first security control to log the presence of a web shell in that particular environment.
So the last time I saw you gave this talk at the San Steve Fire Summit, the one web shell that you went over that I hadn't heard of before that I thought was awesome was Webuku.
Yeah. So Webuku is definitely kind of an interesting web shell in that the command and control or the attacker's access to that web shell once placed on a server uses HTTP cookie headers. And, you know, that obviously can be kind of hard to find. Again, web shells typically are accessed over, web-based protocols such as HTTP. And so in the case of Webuku, not only do you have to be looking at your HTTP traffic, but you got to be looking at the headers to see if there's anything particularly odd there. Now, in that case, Webuku actually encodes much of its information that it's sending to the web shell and receiving from it using Base64, which is fortunate because, you know, you can create IDS signatures looking for Base64 encoded and decoded data. But yeah, it's kind of a challenging world, and I will actually mention one more observation I made as a result of some of the forensic analysis I did, given the context of this forensics lunch here. You know, as I mentioned, one of the technologies I looked most at was with JSP, Java Server Pages. And so when I was doing forensic analysis of a box that was compromised with a web shell, you know, I went ahead and found the web shell, or when I finally found it, I noticed There was more than just a simple, you know, JSP file that represented the web shell. There was a bunch of Java files, a bunch of class files, and the timestamps to me didn't make a whole lot of sense when I compared those to other logs I found on the machine, as well as some of the network captures that we had access to. And you know, I was really reminded, as we are, you know, consistently in this field, how important it is to understand the underlying technologies that we're actually doing forensic analysis on. And so, you know, I'm not a web developer. I didn't have extensive experience with Java server pages. So I kind of downloaded a bunch of publicly available JSP shells, and there are many of them out there, for better or worse, and, you know, in many cases worse. But from the analysis perspective, I was able to download those and play around with them. And you know, what I found was, you know, if an attacker places a, let's say, a JSP file on a publicly accessible server, the timestamps associated with that file, assuming nothing's been manipulated, but assuming that hasn't happened, the timestamps associated with the file will generally correlate with when they placed the file up there, when they uploaded it, perhaps as a result of some sort of an exploit. However, when the attacker first accesses that file, the way the JSP engine works is it actually converts that JSP file into a .java file. It then compiles that .java file into a .class file, and that's what's actually executed. On top of that, you not only have, so let's say you had an original file, test .jsp. It would convert that to a .java file. It would convert that into a .class file. And in addition, it would produce numerous other what are called inner class files. They end with a .class extension. And they basically are produced whenever you define one class within another. And so, you know, from a forensic analyst perspective, you know, typically there will be many inner class files. And so you're looking at this directory that contains, you know, in many cases, 60 or 70 files. And initially, you might think, well, you know, the attacker placed all these files there because they're all associated with a web shell. But the reality is, a lot of that is just how the JSP engine works. And so, you know, you may have started with one simple JSP file that was placed there and resulted with 70 or 80 files, but the attacker really only directly was responsible for one. However, by looking at all of the timestamps associated with those files, you can literally piece together when the initial file was placed there, when it was modified, if at all, when the initial access to that JSP page was made, and when the last access was made. So there's some extremely valuable timestamp information there, but that information can also be extremely misleading if you don't understand how, for example, Java server pages work. And, you know, as you mentioned, I did do a presentation on this, and I also did a webcast for SANS a couple months ago. So for those who want more detail on some of the results of my discussion, I'm happy to post that to the chat so you can take a closer look.
And we'll make sure to link it for those of you watching this recorded. It should be right below. So we have our first question for Anuj. What, from Timothy Sheard, what are some of the common ways you're seeing web shells being installed? Server-side vulnerabilities, exploiting admins at their client, or others?
Yeah, so I mean, in my particular cases, by far, overwhelmingly, that they were installed by use of a server-side exploit. So it could have been an application server that was exploited or the web server. You know, they certainly have been used in certain cases by more advanced threats. You know, once they've penetrated a network, they place a web shell on an external-facing server just for some backup access. But overwhelmingly, when I took a look at them in my cases, they were always there as a result of a server exploit.
Second question from Jess Rutherford is, how is Webacu spelled?
Webacu is spelled W-E-B-A-C-O-O.
And again, I'll put a link to that below if you're watching the recorded. It's already there. I really like you know, this whole discussion, because, you know, a lot of people think that, you know, things have to be really sophisticated for them to be functional. And especially when you start looking at Webacu, which is such a small little piece of eval code that you could really just hide into anywhere. It really shows you just how simple it is. You know, the attacker from there can get really creative. When we were doing our red team exercise last year at the Nationals, we had a guy who just had an eval prompt, and then he was just allowing himself to write freeform Python and Ruby, depending upon which one he was doing. So he didn't have any other built-in functions, but he allowed himself to have freeform interpretation of whatever code he wanted to execute on the system. So, I mean, it could be as complicated as some of the more interesting ones, like, was it R77 that I'm thinking of? Which provides a full interface for database connections and transfers and command prompt emulation and all sorts of fun stuff, to something as simple as just eval this. And they're both equally effective in the hands of the right person.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, they can get very feature-rich to have pretty impressive graphical interfaces, actually. And like you said, they can be incredibly simple as well. So it's scary, frankly. I mean, I'm surprised we don't hear about them more, and I'm afraid that means that we're just not finding them.
I would say you're absolutely right. We're just not finding them. Which comes to our next question from Yogesh Benwell. What integrity checking software used by that client? So in the one I was talking about, Yogesh, they were just doing a source code comparison from Subversion and comparing that to what was currently deployed in the server. So they were doing a comparison between the checked-in code and the code on the disk. Anuj, what have you seen people use effectively?
Yeah, so I mean, the one I mentioned was AID, which is a pretty simple integrity checker for Solaris systems. You know, there's certainly many other out there like Tripwire, and you know, they can all be effective. But again, as I mentioned in the particular story that I recounted, in that case, while AID certainly created a log indicating that the web shell existed, that didn't help at all because no one was looking at the log. And so, you know, at the end of the day, you need, you know, the human actually looking at it for it to mean anything at all. And that's what I've found really is the most important kind of security control here.
And Jason White pointed out it's R57. Yes, R57 is exactly the shell that I'm talking about. And it's a shell that you feel kind of worried about running even in the test environment because it's so many parts of it are obfuscated. You have to wonder what it is you're opening yourself up to just by using it. But with that, Anuj, I hope you can stick around for the rest of the broadcast.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's so much we're going to talk about that overlaps between the gentleman that we have on today. Very excited about the topics as we go along. I can see our viewer count rising as people are coming on, and I think you all are as well, which brings us to our next guest this bi-weekly broadcast, which is Jason Troost. Jason?
Hey, guys. How's it going?
So, Jason, you're with ThreatStream.
That's right.
You guys have put out a project that we highlighted in the last broadcast and that we're opening our community involvement in and whose mapping interface you have right behind you.
Yes, that's right.
So tell us about yourself. Where did you come from? How did you get interested in this? What led you, how did you get buy-off from ThreatStream to turn this into an open source project?
Okay, so I guess just starting, you know, where I came from, I got into security, I would say kind of later than a lot of people. I got into security in college, started a computer science program, and then kind of got interested in hacking and reading hacking books. From there, I went to Georgia Tech and got a master's in information security and got the National Science Foundation Scholarship for Service, which which if you guys don't know what that is, it's a scholarship program put on by the federal government. I'm not sure if it's still around now, but starting in 2003, I believe, the federal government's goal was to get people excited about security and then get them employed at the federal government. So I got one of the scholarships, awesome opportunity. So that, you know, took me through grad school and then also brought me into the federal government. I spent my first 5 years working at the Department of Defense doing InfoSec stuff and kind of transitioned from InfoSec to doing like big data analytics on InfoSec data. For Department of Defense, really, really liked it. At the time, I transitioned to Booz Allen Hamilton, doing very similar work. Left there, went to another company called Endgame, doing, you know, very similar big data security type work, all for the federal government. Really enjoyed that. And then about 10 months ago, I had the opportunity to join ThreatStream. When I joined, I think I was employee number 22. And I kind of heard the concept of the company and saw the team, and it was just really too hard to pass up. But if you guys haven't heard of ThreatStream, what we do is we have a platform for enabling our customers to manage and share threat indicator data. So what I mean by that is really intelligence on IPs, domains, and a bunch of other, you know, cybersecurity-related data. With the goal of allowing customers to crowdsource this data, so as one customer finds information that's relevant to them or their vertical, they can push it into our platform, which does a few things. One is it shares it with the community, and then it also manages the data in their existing security products. So it's kind of like they're getting the benefit of automatic management of their security products, and anyone in our community is getting the benefit of them sharing if they, you know, designate the information to be shareable. So it's been a really exciting 10 months to be here. Several months ago, we stood up a research team, and I'm the lead of the research team. It's called ThreatStream Labs. And ThreatStream Labs is what spawned the Modern Honey Network project. Really, it started off as kind of an internal tool for our own use. We were deploying honeypots and leveraging the data for data feeds for threat intelligence. And we wanted a way to do it. We wanted to make it a lot easier and more scalable. So we spent some time, you know, making a tool for internal use and came to realize this is really useful and it's something we probably should just share with the community. A lot of the stuff we were using were open source tools anyway. We just put a lot of thought into the packaging and installation to make it really easy. And it is, it's been very successful both internally. We use it heavily. We have lots of sensors deployed globally. And then we've had, I have some stats here that I wanted to share. So most recently when we've checked, we've had an MHN server has been deployed about 800 times globally. So we've had people have deployed this software 800 times, and we've had, of those 800 deployments, we've had 400 of them submit 1,000 attacks or 1,000, you know, events or more. We've had 250 submit 10,000 or more. We've had about 75 submit over 100,000 or more. So we have it's a pretty big community of people who have downloaded it and have designated to share their information back. I also have a little bit more information, like some sensors. So in the last 24 hours, we've had 363 unique sensors deployed by the community, not sensors deployed by us, report data back to the community. Since February 1st, we've had 571 report data back, and since January 1st, over 1,000. So it's been very exciting to see this community-driven project grow as fast as it has.
So let's talk about how that sharing is occurring. So when you run MHN, you have an option of whether or not to have the data that's collected in some form or fashion go back to a threat stream in some kind of stream. How does that work?
That works using HP feeds. So when data comes into your MHN system, if you've designated the sharing, we have a daemon that is looking at HP feeds. It's extracting out really just information about the attacker and also metadata about the type of honeypot that was attacked, and it sends that information through HP feeds to our central community hub, and allows us to see that data and then also visualize it on the map.
Great. And so that's an optional thing. You didn't make it mandatory, which was quite nice of you. And again, the project itself is open source, meaning the community key can give back or tweak it or modify it, like we're going to talk about with Matt Bromley here in a bit. How did you talk your bosses into doing this?
I didn't really have to talk them into it. It was really kind of mentioning the idea, and they immediately saw the value in it. Because a lot of the honeypots that we started using initially were open source, there's really no value in kind of keeping this stuff to ourselves. We know that with open source software, the community will contribute things back. We've had quite a bit of contributions with MHN, so people have found bugs. People have patched our version of Kippo to do some interesting things, and people have extended our UI really through community, you know, I guess community-driven reason. So they saw an opportunity to make it better. They submitted a pull request. We reviewed it and merged it pretty quickly. So
very nice, very nice. So in your mind, since you know you're ThreatStream as a whole is benefiting from the project, and the project seems to be getting more and more traction. We're hoping to help push that along as well, and we're looking at doing our own variation to try to get you even more data. What do you see as the future of the MHN project? What's your current roadmap?
What I see as the future is integration points. So we've had a lot of people download and use it. So we've had hobbyists download and use it. We've had academics download and use it for class projects, and then recently we've had quite a few enterprises who've downloaded it and used it. And the major request that we've gotten from them is, I want to be able to integrate this into my SIEM, especially if I deploy it behind my firewall, where the interaction with the honeypots are likely going to be all private IP space. So that doesn't make sense to submit back to the community, but it makes a lot of sense to integrate into your SIEM. So I see integration points. We've started a small project to do this. This was just posted last week. Hasn't really been announced or anything because we're still kind of working through some issues. And we've actually had some people notice it and find bugs and already fix the bugs. So, but the integrations are really with SIMs. So, and we can talk more about that. Might make sense to talk more about that when Mac gets on. But ArcSight, Splunk, Elasticsearch, really any system that you can pump this data into and use it for alerting or combining with your other security data is kind of where I see this going. And then the other one is sensors. So leveraging more and like more tactically driven sensors. During the Shellshock vulnerability announcement, when I think Robert Graham tweeted his config for mass scan for scanning the internet to find this, when we saw that, we're like, we need to put a honeypot out there that can, one, detect that this is, someone's trying to do this, and then two, grab the payload that the attacker will download in order to exploit your box, because almost all of the Shellshock exploit attempts are just shell code or shell scripts that do a wget and then run a shell script. So within about 6 hours, we had a honeypot developed, tested, and then deployed to all of our sensors, and we were starting to collect data. So I see kind of the more tactically driven honeypots as a kind of a trend. And we have a few that we've posted on our public GitHub. They're very, very bare bones, but I think you can take that same model and apply it to really any emerging threat that comes out to start collecting data as fast as possible if your other honeypots don't give you visibility already.
That's a fascinating concept. I mean, it's, I think, the first time I heard someone talk about making a honeypot for a specifically new hot button vulnerability like that. That's really kind of cool. And if you're watching the recorded video, the link to the GitHub that he just talked about is right down below. For those of you watching live, just stick around and we'll make sure we get that to you. That's really neat. One of the struggles that I've been having as we try to turn our MHN server into more of a community project is we're going to have to redo the interface a little bit because we think it's a bad idea for everyone to know each other's sensor IPs because all it takes is one person with a bad sense of humor to decide. in regards to that part of it, what are you seeing? What kind of feedback are you getting?
So I haven't heard of many people deploying it for community use. So I think that is an interesting use case. Now, I'd love to talk more about that probably after the show because that could be some features we build in to make that a lot nicer and a lot easier to share. We kind of assumed that whoever was managing and deploying it would be kind of all on one team or trusted. We didn't really think about having multiple possibly untrusted users interacting with the system. I think that's a great idea, though.
When I looked at it, the first thing I thought was, boy, it would be a lot of fun if we could get everyone to be able to see this together. And anybody who wanted to just throw something up with the condition that if you throw something up, then you get access to the data. And then, of course, that's what got us interested and us talking to Matt and everybody else. And so we're hoping to see just what we can build as a community-driven project. And, of course, we kind of have a different view of what's interesting. So Matt and I are traditionally host-level dead box guys and some live response, but usually more about what interaction the attacker's doing after they get in, not so much about the IPs and the domains and the rest that traditional threat intel is interested in. So we're looking at more of the mid and high interaction honeypots and looking to see what we could do as that data is received by HTTP feeds and stored in Mongo, how we can expose that for trend analysis and looking to see what kinds of things they're interested in more than just where they're coming from, kind of the traditional indicators.
Interesting.
So if someone wanted to get a hold of you or reach out to you or ThreatStream, what was the best way to do that?
To me, probably through Twitter. So at Jason_Trost on Twitter is probably the easiest way to find me, and I can start communicating from there. My GitHub is JT6211. So feel free to find the MHN project, post an issue, and we'll try to address it. Or we also have an MHN mailing list, which is I can't remember what it is off the top of my head, but it's a Google group. It's linked off the MHN project page. That's probably the best way. It's been interesting to see the community grow. Initially, me and one other guy here were answering all the questions, But we've slowly been having other people start picking up and answering questions before we can get to them. So it's a great resource. I highly recommend to send questions to the mailing list as opposed to sending them directly to me. They might get answered quicker.
And for those of us who are looking to actually contribute code back, what's your process here following on your GitHub? Would you rather do it as a pull request and then you can merge it back in? Would you like it to be a submissions? Or how do you see that going?
Pull requests are the easiest for us. So if you go fork the project on GitHub, make your changes in a branch. It's recommended to do it in a branch just in case they don't work out. You can revert them. And then just make a pull request. We might comment and ask you to change some things. Some of the code we have, because it's from a few different places, the whitespace conventions are different. We didn't want to go through and change all the whitespace on all the code for third-party projects. So that's things that we typically have to say, hey, can you fix the whitespace? But other than that, we're really receptive to looking at pull requests and merging them if they make sense.
Great. That's awesome. Well, thank you very much for your time. I hope to have you on again to talk about where the project's going and maybe you can go in and give some commentary on what we've done with it and give us some direction. We very much appreciate all that you've done in building this tool and ThreatStream for supporting it.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
Which brings in, as a dovetail topic straight out of that, into what it is that we've been poking at. And the person, Matt and Matt,
Matt
Bromley. We've been talking, and you and the two Matts have gotten their collective heads together, and let's talk about what it is that you've been looking into.
Yeah. So first and foremost, I just I want to highlight the beauty of MH, and one of the things that Jason was talking about with how easy it is to deploy Honeypot and everything like that. I think it really allows businesses who or companies whatever who have multiple lines of business to actually look at those on a granular level. I like being able, there's an ICS honeypot, there's a WordPress honeypot, there's a Kippo honeypot, or an SSH honeypot. There's so many different ways. MHA brings together, I think, an opportunity for someone to really monitor different types of stuff that's going on. I mean, monitoring your SSH is fantastic, and it's going to blow up like a Christmas tree because of the people who are scanning the internet every single day, but to then say, okay, let me deploy this in my ICS part, let me deploy this over my blog marketing page. And I think it really gives you a very wholesome view of what's going on, which I really like. I love how easy it is to deploy. That being said, obviously we've talked about the test setup that we've gone through here. And David, I think we're probably over 400,000 events, if you will, in the Honeypot that we've got up. And I see new sensors being added every week, which is awesome. So to the community who's watching, please continue to contribute. It's an awesome effort. But when we got that set up, we took a look at the data that was kind of there in the dashboard, and then we also took a look at the data that was underneath. Now, Jason, you didn't go over the architecture, and I'm probably going to butcher it, but I believe that NemoSign, which is a part of either ThreatStream or MHN or something in there, is what's used to kind of hold on to that data or plug it into a back-end MongoDB. That's there.
That's right. NemoSign is actually an open-source project released by the HoneyNet project. We just extended it slightly to integrate with MHN.
Perfect. NemoSign. That's something to remember. So NemoSign puts everything in Mongo, and it stores all different kinds of data. It's going to capture your IPs, your ports, commands that were run, the credentials that were used to log in. There's really a lot of information that's captured in there. So I've been working with Matt, and we kind of took a look at the underlying structure and said, wow, there's all this data inside of Mongo. It'd be awesome if we could get this data into some other visual format. So I heard about this tool called Elasticsearch. I have not really seen too much of it in my career, to be honest with you. But my first thought was let's get this data into Elasticsearch so we can start to look through it. So we started messing around with the ways to get this data in there, and Logstash is a traditional one. There's also scripting, but this is where I get to kind of talk about a nice little Elasticsearch technical feature. Elasticsearch has this thing called Rivers, or it's not a thing. It's more of like a plugin or a feature, if you will, called Rivers. And Rivers lets you basically hook into a streaming data feed and bring that data into Elasticsearch. There's a whole bunch of kind of official supported Rivers and then some community supported Rivers as well that are available on the Elasticsearch website. And luckily, there's one from MongoDB. So to get into kind of Mongo format, the way it works, Mongo by itself is you know, obviously it's another NoSQL data store, but it's a very kind of standalone product by itself. Initial download, default download. It can obviously be replicated and sharded and spread all over the globe, but by itself it's very standalone and it's very kind of, you know, local host. It's bound to 127.0.0.1, and you can log into it from a local shell if you want. So the way that you actually set up this tail, if you will, for Mongo is you make Mongo a replica set. So if you think about kind of a basic layout, if you have two items that are a replica, two items within a replica set, item A and item B, item B is going to want to continue to be a copy of item A, but we're not going to push data to both A and B. So we're going to tell A, hey, whenever you make a change, dump it out to this log, and then B, monitor this log so that you know what changes to make. So the way that this river works, which I think is actually pretty clever, is it sets up a single node Mongo instance into its own replica set. Because what we really want at the end is we want that tailable log afterwards, that op log, as it's called. So it's, I think, Matt, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it's like three commands inside of a Mongo shell. And you're now looking at, you've got a replicated self, or a replicated single node, if you will, with an op log. So we point our Elasticsearch river at that and say, hey, here's our Mongo information, here's the collection that we're interested in, go ahead and ingest. And I tell you, it's one of the fastest ingestions I've seen personally with that. And I've messed around with the bulk inserts and the log stash and all that kind of stuff, and it's just very fast. And it's millisecond updates, too. So we were actually playing around with this last week, and so we couldn't mess around with MHN, or so I didn't break MHN, if you will. I was editing data inside of Mongo, and the changes were being pushed immediately up there. And I think what I'll do now is actually share one of these dashboards that we've got together here.
And for those listening, Matt has actually wrote up the steps he took onto a new blog series on his blog that I'll be linking to below so that you can actually do this yourself and not have to try to furiously scribble down what Matt's just said.
Yes, sorry. All of this is available in extremely meticulous, late-night, infant-driven blog post. So there's lots up there. David, can you guys see what I've got up here? The Kibana dashboard?
Yeah, we see it. It's great.
Okay, perfect. All right. So some of this stuff may start to look familiar if anyone's messed around with MHN before, but if you take a look at the fields that we've got down to the left side of the screen here, first things first.
Your window.
What's that?
I'm going to resize your window.
Oh, is it too small?
A little more. There, perfect.
Good there?
Mm-hmm. Very good.
Perfect. Okay, awesome. So what we've got to the left is our fields, if you will, our fields that we can play around with. And one of the things that we did, Jason, with the Nemesine input is we actually took the payload field, which is a string array by itself. We actually kept it as a JSON format. So when we dump it into Elastic, when we dump it into Mongo in that format, and then when we dump it in, you know, subsequently into Elasticsearch in that format, it then becomes nested fields. So payload.property is our ability of what we can start to search on. So I'll hone in on some, for example, our payload.pyrip, for example. Let me do this a different way. There we go. Our payload.pyrip. We've seeded some random geographical data in there, random geographical IPs. But it gives us the opportunity to, okay, now we can treat this field as an IP address. All right, that gives us a lot of capabilities with analytics and searching. We can also rip all the ports out, so we can start to map, you know, am I getting attacked on one port in general? These events are all, there's 22 events in here that are actually a replication of each other, so they're all going to show up on the same port, So some of the data is intentionally very simple for me to walk through, so it's an easy process to put together. But so we can drill down on port, and then the other beautiful thing that I like too, and this is something else we can start to look at, is I can now start to look at the commands that were run as well. And this is just an array type, but luckily using Kibana on top of Elasticsearch, some of the features actually break this array out into different terms. And we're going to cover this in just a moment. But now I start to say, okay, I can see my commands. I can, if any credentials were captured, and Jason, I'm preaching the choir here, you know what's captured in here, but any credentials that were input, any users that were created, I'm able to capture all this. I think from an analytical point of view, when we're able to take all these fields and break them out into unique little nuggets, if you will, it lets us really expand upon the analytics that we can do. So I put together this really simple dashboard. I just started kind of messing around with it a little bit earlier. I won't go over kind of Elasticsearch query fields and whatnot, but one thing I was able to do is we do have an IP hit that was in Poland. So using a Kibana dashboard, I can color code what I've got in there. And there's other countries as well. Let's see what else we've got in here. Other country names. Okay, we've got United States, China, and Poland. In there, so we can actually wrap other kind of fields in here if you want, and start to look at where else is my data originating from. Bear with me just a second. We'll drop something else in, that give us United States based traffic as well. But I think it was a really neat idea to kind of take all this and branch the data out and put it into a different way to look at it. So we've also dropped in a geolocation map as well that we've got to the side here. And this is actually, there we go. So now we've got United States, Poland, and then all of our traffic in there as well. We've got a better map to one of the Kibana plugins, and this actually lets us drill all the way down into it gets pretty deep down into the drilling. So here's actually what I've done now is refocused our dashboard to focus just on my Poland IP. Now this was just a randomly generated one. It's by no means actually Poland, but I'm guessing this is some sort of Polish building naming convention. I'm not sure. I'd tell you I'd be lost if I was a delivery guy in this particular district. But, using the map, we can drill in very quickly. So from an analytical point of view, from a threat actor point of view, I'm starting to not liking that term. But from all these different points of views, we can take this data and really drill in a different way. The other thing I like about having the data in this format as well is, and you were talking about this a little bit earlier, Jason, is importing into Sims, and I know you guys have like an ArcSight and a Splunk plugin that's out there now too. Now we can start to correlate my honeypot with what else am I seeing? What else has this IP been doing across my environment? Because if you're running Keepo, for example, you're gonna collect a lot of SSH traffic on the particular honeypot. But if you've got that IP doing other things across the network, Keepo's it's a nice extension, but then we get to start to profile. So I like this too as a nice kind of information point as well. In the very rare instance that a SOC or cert team is sitting around doing nothing, they can pop open MHN and start to see what the IPs are looking at. So it was really fun taking all this data that's in here and porting it over. I've got a couple other kind of tables I just threw together as well. Within Kibana, we can actually filter the SSH commands. So this is where I was talking about Kibana is able to parse arrays for us. Right now, it's a population of 22 with the exact same commands. We're filtered on 5 right now. But, we can start to look at, okay, who am I, LS, and exit are, I think, some of the most popular kind of scripted SSH scanners, if you will. So we can start to filter that, but if you extrapolate this to hundreds of thousands of events, then you can really start to filter, okay, what commands are they running? And another thing too, if you want to make your honeypots a little bit better, if you find that your top 5 commands, 3 out of 5 aren't commands and they're returning errors, now you have an opportunity to, within your organization, go and, expand those Python scripts and make your honeypot a little more robust. See if you can actually hook the fish. when it comes in. And then the credentials as well. Again, it's 50-50 because it's the same event, but we've got 50% using root and the password of 123456. So it's just a dashboard. It's some fun creation, but we very quickly get to a different analytical point, if you will, and the ability to kind of look at and analyze our data in a different way.
And this is going to become important because one of the things we're talking about is how we want to make sure that one person can't ruin everyone else's when we take image and kind of beauty view. So we can visualize it and maybe obfuscate the sensor IPs a little bit by doing that, that we can give everyone access to search everyone's data without the ability to ruin anyone else's good time by doing a paste bin dump of all the honey IPs that are out there. The other side of it, and this is something I was talking to with Dr. Johannes from the San Jose Storm Center, is precisely what you're talking about, which is how you make your KIPPO more realistic, because there's lots of people out there who, once they're in, they're going to say, is this just a honeypot that I've stumbled into? Is this too good? And they're actually profiling different commands and seeing what they know the known KIPPO behavior to be. So it's pretty fun to try to keep up that way, and hopefully we can learn from each other and put out a KIPPO build that improves and becomes more realistic. Kyle Maxwell asked the question, what's the URL to start the process of connecting our sensors to your MHN? Right now what we're asking is that people email forensichoney@gmail.com to join us, and if for those of you who have, the reason we haven't responded to you, we are keeping your names, and we are going to be responding, is because we want to make sure that we get the obscured interface correct first before we opened it up anymore to prevent the exact issues I was just talking about. So yes, we have received those of you who have responded. Yes, we will be replying with credentials as soon as we get this in a good state, and we are absolutely asking that everyone else out there who's interested to just drop an email that says, hey, I'm interested, I'm willing to put up a honeypot, wherever you want to do it. You can do it for free in DigitalOcean. You could, with a referral code, you could do it on Amazon Azure. A lot of you out there at work right now, you may have Amazon Azure and not even realize you have free credit. If you have an MSDN account or any type of Visual Studio license, you may have $100 to $150 of free cloud hosting, and Azure has both Windows and Linux VMs pre-built that you can just stand up and run the deploy script and be up and running. That's pretty cool. You could do it at home, and if you're really cool, you can talk to your boss doing it at work, because let's be honest, the external IP address space assigned to your business is probably the most interesting IP address space there is, beyond just the shared cloud space that you have from the different providers, Amazon AWS, DigitalOcean, Azure, the Google Cloud, any of these kind of clouds that let you stand at VMs are obviously going to be targeted and scanned, but nothing like the special love you get from the IPs that you own yourself. So, Matt, with that said, I'm hoping that we can wrap this into something that we can show to the rest of the world and keep doing the fun ones.
Yep, no. Can you guys hear me? Sorry, definitely. If I could, too, David, I was going to just steal the screen for just another second here to possibly extrapolate upon what Kyle was saying, and also for anyone who maybe didn't catch the last one and is interested. Once you've got, this is just a test instance I've got running, but once you've got MHN up and running, and I'm not kidding, it is actually this easy, and huge props to Jason and his team for making it this easy. It's a drop-down list. Everything's right now Ubuntu, but I can tell you for a fact it does work on Debian as well. And then you select the honeypot that you want. And then let's say we want to deploy a KIPPO, for example. You then get a deploy command. You run that on your honeypot or your intended honeypot machine, assuming they can connect to each other, and that's it. Assuming everything works, you're off to the races. You've now got a honeypot that's working. It takes care of all the HP feeds configuration for you. It takes care of sending all that data out, and you can actually scroll down if you want and edit the script as well. So, for example, if you'd rather set if you'd rather set the real SSH port, if you will, to something other than 2222, you can change that. If you'd like to change the usernames, whatever it may be, the deployment is very, very simple, and these guys have made it great to get this out there. So along with the a very effective management, the deployment is another very easy feature as well.
I would absolutely agree. And if it's something where you're worried about not having a machine, or you're worried about a machine being shared, we've been running these on Raspberry Pis and BeagleBoards. For $35, you get a Honeypot. Nothing wrong with that.
Hey, you can go online and get a free $10 from DigitalOcean, and that's 30 days of that's 60 days, because you can get a $5 a month droplet. So you can contribute for 2 months for free.
And we're going to be passing around Ken Pryor's referral code, since he's the one who started all this in my mind. And Ken, I have gotten your message, and I will be replying to you if you're watching this. Just been a little behind. So I think all of that is fascinating. And I think, you know, what Jason has started with this project is something that I'm hoping that the wider community will continue to embrace, and we can really start making some really cool data that not only will help us as current examiners. I think it's going to help students who are looking to learn more about those professors who want to create classroom projects. Jason already alluded to this, and some professors are setting this up inside of their academic environments. But creating real data sets that can be shared and that can be looked upon, mined, trends found, analytics, interesting information. Everyone has a different view of what's interesting to them, but the data itself is useful to everyone. And this is one of those fascinating things about what we're calling the spectrum of digital forensics and incident response, and kind of its place in the broader information security community, is there is so much data, and we all are looking for our own purposes. But the more we share with each other, the more we both find uses for it. It's data is data, and it's all good data. We want all the data we can get. So, if you're watching this live, many of you have asked questions, and I really appreciate that. I love when we get interactive. And we still have time for you to ask questions. So if you just want to click in to the video, it'll let you pop up and do that. Of course, you have to have a Google account, unfortunately, to do so. I don't doubt they're going to change that anytime in the near future. But we welcome your questions. But with a couple minutes left, I want to make sure that I talked to the esteemed gentleman from the United Kingdom, Lee Whitfield.
Well, before I start going off on something completely different, I just want to get everyone's thoughts on this Facebook Fed Exchange thing which has popped up. And it seems like all three of you may have something to say or have some input about. So, I'm just looking for what you guys think about it.
We'll go in my order on the screen. Jason?
I think it's a great idea. I think the more that the security community is sharing data amongst each other, especially in real time and especially at scale, the better we all are. So I think the more of these sharing platforms, the better, to be honest.
Anoush?
Yeah, I mean, I haven't read up too much on it, but when I heard about it, I actually immediately thought of ThreatStream. I mean, that business model is getting more popular, and I think for a reason, because holding all this data private is limited, and when it comes to threat intel, it's hard to capture intel. We're the only one, generating that data, and I see very little downside, as long as people's, private data is secure. I see very little downside to receiving more of it.
I hope it works. I really do. I hope that that people contribute. I hope that people give back. I hope people make use of it. I've signed up for it personally, and I know when you sign up, there's two roads you can take, you can either drive one or drive both. And one is I need info, and the other is I want to share info. It becomes something, because you make a good point, David. Just get the data out there, and then we can start to do things with it. We can start to get better with it, I hope. So I hope it works.
I clicked the link, and I signed up. I don't know when I'll hear something, but I definitely clicked the link. And Yogesh, I see your question. We actually, I guess you are mind reader. Yes, we just talked about Facebook's Threat Exchange program. So there you go, Lee.
Cool.
Do you have any thoughts on it?
I just assume it must be evil because it's from Facebook. But No. I think it's a great idea. And, as we've been sitting here talking about everything which we have been talking about, it just seems that it's a perfect fit for a lot of people.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, cool. Well, I'm glad. Thanks, guys. So there's a couple of things I just want to highlight that from this last couple of weeks. One is that Magnet Forensics has released its own memory acquisition tool. They offered that for free. So go ahead and try that out. Just wanted to just highlight that. And then another cool thing that Access Data are doing is that you can test drive any piece of their software completely free, no credit card required, for 20 days. So,
if you can see my face right now, it is one of doubt and stun.
What they say on the website. So,
I think a new company needs to be started. 20-day consulting.
And every 20 days you start a new company.
Yeah, exactly. What brand new VM, wipe the registry, and boom, new Access Data. If it can't solve in 20 days, we don't take it.
That's the best idea I've heard in a long time.
Nice. And then kind of the final thing I really wanted to talk about was the agenda for the SANS Forensics Summit.
Oh, yeah.
Has been released now. You can go and find that online. It's very, very easy to find. And in amongst the people who are going to be speaking this year, we've got...
Lee Whitfield.
Yeah, we have Lee Whitfield. But there's more important people speaking also. So Kyle Maxwell, who was on the show last week, is going to be speaking there. Matt, he's going to be also speaking. So there's good times to be had by all there. Thing to bear in mind is that previous years they've been doing it at the Omni Hotel in Austin. This year there is a change of venue, so please don't book your stay at the Omni Hotel. It's going to be at the Hilton Austin, just on 4th Street, so it'll be even closer to all of the fun activities down there. So as part of the Forensic Summit, and you knew I was going to go here, the Forensic Forecast Awards will be taking place. And last week, when we were talking about this, there was a couple of things that I forgot to mention. So the first thing I forgot to mention was that I think I forgot to mention like when the date before everything. So end of March, that's the cutoff point for nominations. Then we start the voting, and that will cut off sometime probably beginning of June. The second thing I forgot to mention was that there's two brand new categories this year that we should be trying out. First one is the Forensic Presentation of the Year, and the second one is Forensic Course or Class of the Year. So if you've been on a class that you think is particularly fantastic, I've butchered your name. He has a great class. You could nominate him. We've also, and then, like I said, the presentation of the year too. And I don't get out to very many conferences, unfortunately. But what I can say is that having been at the Forensic Summit last year, we were spoiled for choice. We really were. We had some fantastic presentations and even some synchronized dancing from Kyle Maxwell and his presenting partner. So please go and post some nominations and then return in a month or so to post your votes.
Yeah, I mean, at this point, I think I've been to the majority of the forensic conferences that exist in the United States in one form or another, and I can say that the San Steve Fire Summit is the most technical out of all of them. If you want to go to a mid-sized group and actually talk to people who are doing the work and doing the research and can sit down and talk structures and just get straight into it, it's the place to go. And Anoush, speaking of your class, I have not taken your class. It's something that I actually want to do. When are you teaching next?
Yeah, so thanks for asking. So the next class is actually going to be later this month. It's in Monterey, California. It starts on Monday, February 23rd. And we do still have seats left, so if you want to learn a bit about malware and a little bit more SUN, I guess, depending upon where you are in the world, I encourage you to join us.
And if someone wanted to contact you, because I forgot to ask you, what's the best way to get a hold of you?
Yeah, sure. So, my Twitter handle is @ASONI, so @ASONI, and my email address is my first name, Anuj, .mylastname@gmail.com. So either of those will work.
And I'll have a link to... his most recent classes, obviously, more than once a year. but the one coming up. And for those of you in the Northeast who may have had some training budget open up, it is much warmer in Monterey, California in the next couple weeks, and it will be where you are, because I just saw the forecast talking about the next blast of Canadian Arctic air that's heading your way. So if you want to escape that and learn all about reverse engineering, a very good opportunity. Yogesh Benwell has one more question. He said, I haven't received any answer from Facebook yet. Do you have access to the Threat Exchange portal? I don't. Does anyone else here do that? That can, in some form or fashion, talk about it?
This is where I second my comment of I hope it works.
we have access to it. It does work.
So there you go. So it's a real thing. It's not just a sign-up page. that is a legitimate concern. Let's be honest. It could be a giant farming operation to match Facebook profiles to threat intel people, and not that they couldn't do that already. So with that, the hour is up. The questions seem to have ended. I want to thank everyone for coming in today. Again, how to contact them, their blogs, their Twitters, and what they talk about today will be linked right down below. If you're looking at this on the blog page, I'll put it within the comments. If you're looking at this on the YouTube page, it's right down below the video itself. Please, if you enjoy this, if you liked it, tell your friends. We do this for you. So you can either follow us on Google+, Twitter, subscribe to the YouTube channel. However you want to get it, we try to be everywhere. And we'll see you in 2 weeks when we have on another great show with Ben Lemire from Berlitech Tech talking all about car forensics. And as well as Robin Kerr from CrowdStrike talking about what they've been doing with CrowdResponse and the new implementation of SuperFetch to do so. There's some really cool stuff they're doing there. So thanks for watching. See you next time. Hope you enjoyed the show. And again, thank you to Jason Trost.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Anoush, Tony.
Thanks for having me. Thank you.
And of course, Matt Bromley.
Thanks. Fun as always.
And Lee Hu is in the office with us today.
And thank you. By the way, Matt's beard is fake. He just puts it on for the...
You weren't supposed to say anything. And we almost made it the entire show without you saying anything about it.
We'll see you next time.